Hendrik Poinar specializes in ancient DNA and ancient protein evidence of evolution. Where he's different from some of what we've heard about ancient DNA is that he's specialized in how our diseases have evolved. He's a professor and Canada research chair at McMaster University. And when he was here visiting in Madison, I sat down and talked with him about his recent exciting work uncovering the causes of the medieval Black Death, an epidemic that had such great importance for world history.
You've been working on the other side of, you know, the human evolution story, in a sense, because you're looking at our predators.
That's right. Yes, that's right. So the co-evolution with our bacterial hosts and those that try to get rid of us, so to speak. That's been a true fascination of mine, I would say, in the last sort of 3 or 4 years.
So how did you get into working with ancient DNA, ancient, just sort of, you know, that sort of ancient biomolecule field?
I mean, I grew up in an academic family. I had a paleontology dad and I had a bioengineering mother. And somehow I thought, I love paleontology, although I found some of the stories too much hand-waving for me at the time. And I found bioengineering fascinating, but I said, somehow there's got to be a mix. So that's right when molecular biology came out. And so, you know, looking at some of these fossils, you realize they were just phenomenally well-preserved. And there had, I was convinced there had to be organic residues somehow, constituents still buried within these fossils, even though they looked permineralized, I figured. And so that was really the beginnings, was can we devise novel ways to look at these sort of organic traces and build time machines, so to speak, molecular time machines.
I mean, it's really, you know, we're trained about the same time. And when we started, this sort of stuff was really science fiction.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. No, this was the impossible, and there's, you know, theoretical limits imposed on biomolecule survivability, and so you couldn't go past a certain age, and so on and so forth. And I was convinced that there wasn't, you know, that we really didn't understand the preservation of biomolecules at a chemical and a preservational context, and to what degree things would survive, and when things actually wouldn't survive. And so that was really the thrust, my interest in, you know, could we develop, you know, novel ways to look at these residual components, whether they be proteins or carbohydrates or lipids, and then move into the more fragile molecules like DNA and RNA. So, you know, some people are trying. So
if you want to look for the bacteria that are, you know, potentially infecting ancient people, do you have to do different things than you would to look for the DNA of the people themselves? You know, or is it sort of the same stuff?
No, it's sort of the same stuff. And those, you know, the ancient DNA moved along quite quickly. I mean, we've gone through, you know, sort of deaths and births, and we're in a rebirth right now because the technology has changed. But there had always been two sort of limiting factors on what we could get. One was human, which was a big problem because the techniques at the time using standard PCR were that you would amplify the contamination over the actual residual degraded DNA in there. So we couldn't get human. And the bacteria was this sort of unknown, you know, we know 2% of the actual diversity, and how do we know if it's really ancient anyways? And so, no, we target it in the same fashion. So it's in a clean room setting. And we you know, if teeth seem to be particularly good for preserving that, both the calculus as well as the pulp within the tooth cavities are quite good. Better than bone, only because bone is quite porous.
Yeah.
Bone is like a sponge. So becomes a bit difficult, more difficult to look at genomic, metagenomic profiles and know really what's surrounding environment and what's actually endogenous microbiome. But no, we start with the same material. So that which we use the extract-wise to access the ancient human DNA is also the same extract that we then use to target the bacterial population.
Okay, so some of your work that's gotten attention recently is the work on the bubonic plague. How did that start?
Well, that started years ago in 99. Sharon DeWitt, actually, he's now at the University of South Carolina, came to me when I was at the Max Planck and said, you know, we've got these plague teeth, and can we look at them? And could we find, you know, what the causative agent was? So it was a real interest in whether or not we could go to the bacterial level. And then, of course, there was this overriding question of what caused, although cause with big quotation marks around it, what was, you know, the etiological agent of the Black Death.
So these were initially teeth from the last 1,000 years.
That's right. Uh-huh. Yeah, yeah, from about 1340s, uh-huh. 1345, 46. Mm-hmm. So not, you know, relatively recent time when you think about the span of human evolution. But of course, we're talking about an epidemic that claimed 50 million people.
Yes.
That took 5 years to spread, basically from the Golden Horn all the way into parts of Norway.
Uh-huh.
And that represented about 40 to 50% of the European population at the time. So nothing like we've seen.
Yeah.
Right? That's a mortality rate. You know, if we, by comparison, 50 million people died in the 1918 flu, and that represented a mortality rate of 3%. Maybe.
So. Yeah, so you're looking at one of the most deadly diseases that ever existed in humans.
That's right.
Worry you?
Well, that's why I send graduate students to
your application is just way zero.
No, everybody survived, people. There was interesting this. It was that was a concern for a lot of people, but you know, people have been excavating these sites for years, and uh-huh. you know, the museum, the British Museum. In London has collected, you know, the East Smithfield sites from the uh-huh. 80s and earlier, and there's been no, you know, outbreaks of it. Although in the recent identification of this new Crossrail site in London, the uh-huh. Parliament brought it up as the potential for, do we have to worry about reemergence of this pathogen coming from these plague pits that we're now digging up to build new tube lines?
Uh-huh.
So I think it's probably a viable question, except that when we look at the DNA extracted from these bugs, we see that it looks like the ancient human DNA in the sense that it's all degraded to little tiny fragments.
So it's not functional DNA by any means. Yeah.
No, it would be hard to imagine that you'd have intact bacterial genome, not only bacterial genomes, but actual bacterial resuscitatable bacteria, uh-huh. so to speak.
So you continued with this work, and you know it. You know the technology obviously improved.
Yeah.
You know, how are you going into it? You know, you're trying to discover basically why this plague was so bad.
I think there were two questions. Yeah, one was, can we identify one of these etiological agents that have been proposed? You know, anthrax, smallpox, some other kind of.
Oh sure, because not everybody was convinced.
No, not everybody
that this was the bubonic plague.
That's right.
That we know asbestos. Here today.
That's right. Yeah. No, so if you look at the transmission trends between sort of modern bubonic plague and that in the Black Death, and you look at some of the symptoms, there were differences.
Uh huh.
And so that led to a host of people publishing different things, saying. It was anthrax, it was uh-huh. some hemorrhagic fever, it was... So there was initial interest in, well, let's try to identify what mm-hmm. we think is really the cause of agent. Then let's see if we can access virulence regions mm-hmm. that might have explained why it killed 40% of the European population.
Uh-huh.
And would that then help us address this coevolution that we've had with you know, humans and disease over the past mm-hmm. 800 so odd years.
Yeah, so yeah. this work is still going on.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Yeah, it continues today.
Yeah, but can you give us sort of a short description of, you know, what do you think is the most important part of it at this point?
Oh, that's a good question. The most important part is that, you know, we're looking at the bug. We've started these experiments, and I have to admit they're biased because mm-hmm. the technology that we have currently allows us to fish, you mm-hmm. know, these molecules out of a pool of uninteresting molecules.
Right.
At a very low percentage, right? Uh-huh. We're talking about 0.00001%.
Yeah.
Right. So we have to devise ways to fish them out. But the fishing poles that we use to you know, grab them are actually fishing poles designed with modern bacterial sequences in mind. So we bias our experiments by saying, I think it's Yersinia. So we design arrays, enrichment arrays,
right.
built on Yersinia. We go in, we trap. So it's sort of like the old population genetics where they found the markers in English or European populations and they went out looking for diversity out there. So,
and the reality is, I mean, as you mentioned, our knowledge of bacterial diversity today is not complete.
You know,
it's really limited.
That's right.
And so you're looking for things, and the only tools you have are what you know already.
That's right.
But you could be looking for something that nobody's noticed yet.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Absolutely. And so that's it. That's a big problem, and something we're trying to address actually with additional work that we're doing right now, which uh-huh. is actually to screen human remains for a wide diversity of pathogens uh-huh. using a novel array that will look at basically a family, genus, species, strain, basically level. So you could, so we can potentially identify novel families of bacteria and viruses now.
I want to sort of remind people that you're looking at DNA that is broken into really little bits. And what may be important for this ancient strain is some small bit of the genome. And you're trying to find that bit.
That's right.
And you've got to reconstruct that genome from the tiny pieces.
That's right.
And you've got to be able to do that across many different cases.
That's right.
Where you don't know for sure if one particular skeleton is necessarily somebody who died from the plague.
That's
You might think it's really likely based on where they were found.
Yeah, that's right. So in cases like England, where you have East Smithfield, where, you know, the king purchased the land, and you really have wills and testaments that say where the people were buried, in those cases are good. But then you have a lot of these pit burials where two or three or ten individuals where you have no idea, right? So it's a complete hunt. And there was, so we've devised actually new techniques to actually look at pathogen content and then build arrays based on what we think is present.
Now, a lot of, I'm interested in that because, you know, there are other pathogens.
Absolutely.
And
well, that's a major question, right? I mean, here I've told you that, you know, the etiological agent of the Black Death is plague. Well, but come on. These are people living in 1345, 46 London. This was not necessarily a happy time, right?
Yeah.
So were they co-infected? Of course they were co-infecting pathogens at the time. Was this a population primed for destruction because they were, you know, I mean, we know that the weather had changed. It was cold. It was wet. There was famine. We know that you have opportunistic infections when you're starving. So, right? So the question is really why this, you know, massive mortality occurred really requires not only looking at the virulence factors in specific target pathogens, but also stepping back and looking at the whole microbial flora at the time.
Right. Now, people, I think, generally know that humans are not the only things that evolve. But you mentioned coevolution, and we have these pathogens. You know, the plague is an important one, but there are many others. And and how do you approach studying their evolution?
Well, so, I mean, of course, there's two ways. What most people do that work in modern genomics or genetics is take modern strains and sequence the genomes and then try to assess the rate of evolution based on differences on these phylogenetic lineages. But what I think is so important, certainly for bacteria and viruses, is really to sort of have these temporal timestamps, really to establish sort of rates of evolution. And that gives us an idea on rates and also gives us an idea on if we know major selection events took place, how did that shift the genome and what was the co-response in the humans at the time?
Sure.
I think so plague represents this phenomenal case in point where you have presumably a novel emergence of a rodent disease that slips into humans because it's normally a rodent disease, right?
Yeah.
We're just accidental hosts, unfortunately. And we have this, you know, massive human bottleneck, so there must be, you know, a signature within the human genome. And studying that in present day is very difficult, as you know better than I. Looking for selection in the human genome is no easy task.
Yeah.
But if you could take human skeletons from right before, during and then after, of course, you narrow the issues of...
You're really helped with plague as a model because you know that there were times when it was spreading.
That's right.
And compared to something like smallpox, where it was probably there at a low level all the time.
That's right.
You know, then it's much more difficult to put a clock on that.
That's right.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's the beauty of this sort of novel emergence and then subsequent evolution from there. Because we have subsequent outbreaks, so it stuck around in Europe for a couple centuries and then disappeared.
I think, you know, what is really exciting about this to me is a lot of people, when they think about human evolution and are thinking about, you know, really the entire fossil record of our evolution up until maybe 20,000 years ago is very sparse. You know, we've got a lot of specimens, but they are sparse in their representation of time and place.
Yeah.
And what people may not appreciate is that when you look at the last 1,000 years, last 2,000 years, we've got really large samples of ancient skeletons.
Yeah.
We know a lot more about the contexts in which they lived and died.
Iconography of the time, historical documents are phenomenal. Yeah.
And this is really, you know, epidemiology that you're doing.
It is.
In the
past. Yeah, but that's the way we look at it. I mean, so we and it's really important to point out that I only form a very small part of a larger collaborative mm-hmm. effort to mm-hmm. look at. You know, we have David Earn and Statistics at Mac, who's been digitizing mm-hmm. the archival records from mm-hmm. 1665, as well as the 1345 will and testaments, mm-hmm. and looking at epidemic growth curves. And we see this huge shift, and so there's a modeling side, there's obviously the genomic side, there's the human side, the coevolution side, there's the whole microbiome aspect of, you know, co-infecting pathogens at the time. So there's an environmental aspect to it. So, no, it's a fantastic time. I'm not sure I would want to live in that particular time and place. The good thing is that according to, you know, we passed the current draft genome that we have through this CARD, which is an antibiotic. You basically can test for sensitivity to antibiotics. And it looks like this strain of Yersinia would be tetracycline non-resistant, so sensitive. So
if you travel back in time...
So if I travel back in time, I'm taking tetracycline. I could sell it for a lot on the market.
You'd be the magic man.
I would be the magic man. Snake oil and...
All right, so let me ask you a little bit. If you were advising students, and you do advise students, you know,
yeah.
How do you get into this kind of work? You know, what kind of advice would you give them?
Well, I mean, you know, I tend to have students. I have students that come from a wide range of disciplines. So I have math students. I have students who've done undergraduate studies in genetics. Mm-hmm. Those that come straight out of anthropology, archaeology, mm-hmm. Biochemistry. So we have people doing mass spec work. We have people. So, you know, it's really just a healthy mm-hmm. Interest in interdisciplinary studies and the yeah. ability to not only, you know, you have to obviously be able to focus on a particular project at hand, but don't forget that there's a forest out there and one needs to see that entire forest to really to address the major questions. It's not only about a pathogen, it's not only about climate variability at a particular time, it's not only the human perspective, it's this larger. So I tend to take students like that and then we mix them up in the lab and
that
see
is
how
great.
It works.
Yeah, yeah, you're telling these stories and you need yeah. people with different
Absolutely.
Experience, expertise.
Absolutely. Yeah. The work wouldn't work without it.
All right.
Yeah.
Anything else you want to add?
I'm happy to keep talking about plague as long as you want. Thanks for having me.
Oh, it's been just great. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Jeff.